What's up, Doc? It's Dr. Christian Jessen. From Friday Night Dinner, it's Tom Rosenthal and their team captain, John Richardson. And facing them tonight, Northern Soul, it's Sarah Millican. Wakey Wakey, it's Lorraine Kelly. And their team captain, John Locke. Now, welcome your host, Jimmy.
Welcome to 8 out of 10 Cats Uncut, a show all about opinion polls, surveys and statistics. Did you know, for example, 25% of men think their eyes are their best feature? Let me think. Buns, guns, pecs, nads, little Jimmy Johnson, eyes. Sixth best. Six. The world's oldest goldfish was 42. He put his long life down to regular early morning swims. And the average life expectancy in the UK is 80 years. Does not include Scotland. Terms and conditions apply. Right, let's get started. What are you talking about? That's the name of our first round. Tonight, it's our panelists' job to guess what the British public think of the top five most important moments in life. Sean Steen, what do you think's up there?
What do you think? Loose women.
Is it falling in love?
Well, yeah.
Come on, when did you first fall in love?
Maybe 21. You see, I thought there was the one, because I'd read too many, you know, that kind of books and seen that kind of film where there's just one and that's it, and it's rubbish. If you're, you know, watching at home and people in the audience, there's five. There's not one.
I've seen a lot of those films and read a lot of those books.
Every decade. You have one for... So I've done my 20s, I've got a nice one in my 30s, and then he'll have to go soon, because I'm 36. He's lovely, it's a shame. 40s, 50s, 60s, and then after that, you just have, like, no strings attached sex with whoever's in the same home.
You're such a romantic, aren't you?
I am.
And Lorraine, when did you first fall in love?
Oh, probably about 16.
16?
Yeah, Brian Kennedy. I can't tell you any more than that, but it was lovely. It was
Why can't
really
you tell
good.
Us any more?
Because
is he dead?
I don't want him back. No, he's not dead. I think first love is really important, and you can really not underestimate it because it's really exciting, and because it's all new and you've never been there before. And
I cannot.
It's fabulous.
Wait.
Are you remembering it all?
Sean, you never really talk about your softer side and being in love. Mm. And I think I speak on behalf of everyone. I'd like to see a bit of the real you.
Yes.
When did you fall in love, Sean?
Well, I always find that the confusing thing about falling in love is the symptoms of falling in love, a sort of lightheadedness, giddiness, are very similar to the symptoms of carbon monoxide poisoning. I'm not sure whether I'm in love or the flu's blocked. No, I can't. I don't know if you're the one or we need to change flats. Let's have a word with the landlord.
John, have you ever been in love?
The first two people I fell in love with...
Two?
Hedge your bets. Different occasions, both ended with their partners telling me to stop phoning their home. The first one was a clown, who I fell in love with when I was about 8. He opened a shopping centre near me, and I was transfixed. This guy could juggle, he could do magic, he had poems.
The clown, and how old were you?
Clown must have been in his late 20s, early 30s. I'm maybe 9 or 10. I asked for a picture. He's given me his card. It's only got his phone number on it. He obviously wants me to call. I left a few messages. And one day when I phoned up, his wife picked up that bitch.
This sounds like an implausible story that the clown told the police. Like, no, he was calling me.
I like the idea of you phoning out and going, what are you wearing? I got the big shoes on.
It wasn't a sexual thing, it was just the love between a child and a clown.
When did you first fall in love with a woman?
In Torquay, on holiday. Took her to see Men in Black. Rained on the way out, give my coat, did the whole thing. Little pity kiss at the end of the week, which I'll be honest, I may have misread. Started phoning. She's not picking up the phone either, little minx. So what I did, bought one of those school exercise books, and across every line of every page, I wrote I love, and then her name. If I made a mistake, tore the page out, and then I posted it to her.
Not creepy, Glenn, that's not creepy.
Symbol of commitment and grammatical accuracy.
Well, let's have a look and see whether first love is one of the most important moments in life. Most men say that when they fall in love, they can't tell if it's the real thing. I can. I have a special little indicator that sticks up. OK, Johnston, what's the other most important moment in life?
People do babies, don't they?
Sound like litter.
I think the only reason I want to have kids is so I can look at other people's without being accused of being a paedophile. When you walk past a... I don't mean in that word.
No, dig yourself out of this. I'd love to see this. He's got a shovel. He's on your marks, John, and dig your way out of that one.
Sometimes you're walking past a playground.
Sure. He's going deeper before he even starts the dig.
Sometimes you're walking past a playground and you just want to be able to watch the abandon of children. It's like watching nature. It's like when you watch the leaves change in autumn. Sometimes you want to watch a kid on a swing and think, oh, I used to be on swings before I had jobs and before people judged me and before I wasn't allowed to be in a park. And then before you know it, you've been there half an hour and someone says, oh, which one's yours? You go, I'll go then. Fine. I'm not. It's a nice, and sometimes
you
a baby
say,
will look
what
at you.
Should say is, I haven't chosen yet.
Sometimes they look at you though. Sometimes you're on a train.
They look at you.
I'm not the weirdo yet. You're the weirdos for making it weird, weirdos. Sometimes you're on a train and a baby looks at you and smiles, just in a way a baby would, and yet you want, as a woman, if you look over and pull a face, you go, oh, it's the maternal instinct kicking in, she's just communicating with the baby. If I look over and go, get Captain Weirdo off the train,
John,
please?
It sort of depends on whether or not you've got your cock in your hand.
Dr. Christian, is there anything that we can do to get John chemically castrated? You haven't got kids.
Absolutely no desire to have children whatsoever. Yeah, you can't... They just linger too long and you can't have a
they
life.
They do linger, don't they?
Yeah.
They go on living is another way to say
they go on.
They linger. Yes. I mean, if they lasted 5 years, it'd be perfect, but no.
Like a small chihuahua, you know, it's 6 years and then on with your life, but no. That's my issue. It's a selfish issue, I know. But...
Can I just clarify the chihuahua thing that you said a couple of seconds ago? Does that mean that you're counting down till it dies? Because you said, like, 6 years and then on you go.
I don't have a chihuahua.
OK.
He did until recently, but it hit six. In the bin. The funny thing about chihuahua is they're the one dog you can flush.
I never wanted kids, really. I just wanted one of those big American fridges. You know, the really, really big ones. Yeah. But I thought it'd be ridiculous. I get one of those, it's just me and my partner there, and like a lasagna and a lemon rolling around in it. I thought, better have some kids, fill it out with yogurt.
Well, I didn't think that I was very maternal until I had my baby.
Isn't that a bit late, though?
Yeah.
Really, that's fine, isn't it?
But then it was fine. No, honestly,
but,
you know...
But what if it wasn't? You can't put it back in, can you? You can't, can you?
No. But see, if you do have every drug under the sun, don't... If somebody comes at you...
Not
with,
whilst you're pregnant,
no,
I should confirm.
No, but in labour, have everything. You know these folks that lie on bean bags and they have candles? No. No. You want to be numb, as God intended. You want to be numb from the waist down, knowing nothing about it until they give you your beautiful baby.
That's conception or birth.
Well... honestly, have everything.
I've never heard anything more Scottish than that. Take all the drugs that you can. Seriously, all of them. Get all of them. It's brilliant. It's like you only had the baby for the high.
No, but it is really. Honestly, I recommend
it. It's expensive, though.
No, it's on your NHS.
They've worked out.
No, it doesn't cost asked you anything. It's like the National Health Service.
No, no, he's saying having children,
not... raising children.
Not the drugs. I know a guy that can get it for a favour.
Yeah, to raise the child is something that the average they've had through its lifetime is £200,000. Yeah. And that's not factoring in daddy's drinking, daddy's gambling.
It's all worthwhile when they turn 13 and tell you that they hate you and wish you were dead.
But then they'll look after
I'll
you.
I'll fast-track that.
They'll look after you when you're old.
What?
When you're old, they'll look after you. All the money that you've paid out, they'll have to...
I'm going to use the money I save to look after me. Although I don't have kids, because tragically my girlfriend and I can't have children the way we do it. Let's see whether having children is one of the most important moments in life. I have a feeling it will be. Yes, of course. Number one. Yes, having children. Doctors warn women should have a baby by the age of 35 to avoid the risk of being deafened by their ticking biological clock. In 2009, Nadia Suleiman of California gave birth to octuplets, two daughters and six sons, earning her the nickname Octomum, although she's also known as Gigantosnatch. Shaunstein.
Getting your first job, that's a very significant rite of passage in life, isn't it? And I remember my first job, it was actually in a mental home. It's wicker work, mostly. you got special boots, as much tea as you could drink. Actually, one of my first jobs was in a psychiatric hospital. I used to work in the kitchens. I was a kitchen porter. And one of my first jobs, this is true, was, you know, those industrial bins, those big, sort of proper big bins, they're big, like, big drums, and I used to fill up with food. And towards the end of the week, the patients would try and eat the food that was sticking out the top of the bin. And of course, pigeons have been crapping in it the whole time. So it wasn't a particularly healthy option for them. And my job was to shoo them away from the bins.
So you were a scarecrow for nutters?
Yeah. I was a scare loony. And I was standing there going, yeah, yeah, shoo, shoo, shoo. Then I sit down, read the Daily Mirror, have a fag. And they start coming around the corners again. And I go, yeah!
It sounds like the worst zombie movie ever.
Do you not think maybe they were coming around the corner to see the man nuttier than them? They think, wait, Matt, there's a man around there. You go near the bin, he goes batshit.
Hey, John, first job?
I had loads of jobs. First job, milk monitor.
You don't need to start right at the beginning of the list.
Got to take it seriously, Joe. I turn up at 6 in the morning, make sure the milk tray's clean. Just phone the dairy up. Just all right, Steve. Yeah, three of them didn't have straws on last week. Don't take the piss, mate.
Presumably your first job was as a doctor when you qualified as a doctor.
Yeah, junior doctor. I do not miss those days at all, really.
You see, when you're a junior doctor and someone dies in hospital in the night, you have to go and certify them dead.
Officially. Well, I could do that.
And I know it sounds silly, but I'd never been taught how to do this. And it's quite scary, I'll tell you that now. And you kind of go in and you go, you're right. And obviously they're not all right at all. And then I was doing it once and you sort of give him a big push like this and it was a poor old man and you went,
ugh. You want to come back in half an hour?
Open, and I just... pegged it out of there. Apparently, he was actually dead.
Do you think just before you die, if you thought, I'm going to say, I'm
going
to
play my final gag, no, take a deep breath, hold it
I'm
in.
I'm dead.
Let's have a look and see whether the first job is one of the most important moments in life. Yes, indeed, getting your first job. Britain is home to one of the most hard-working, industrious and reliable workforces in Europe, the Polish. John, Tom, Christian, what are the most important moments in life?
You never really forget, like, the day I passed my driving test, probably the most significant. Because then you can go anywhere, can't you? Get the motor running. I mean, it won't surprise anyone to learn that I received a minor on my driving test for excessive caution. That's right, ladies. Really annoyed me. You know you're a fanny when on your driving test the instructor's saying, so when I tap the dashboard, I want you to slow down, but for the rest of the time, can you friggin' strap on a pair? And just put your foot down.
I think it's a big time for, you know, teenagers passing their test. I just think it's a very strange thing that we pick that time in life to give kids the opportunity to drive. You know, it's the most sort of hormonally volatile you can be. So are you emotionally insecure and randomly aggressive? Here, have a machine that can kill yourself and others. You know, like.
When can you apply for your provisional license?
I do drive a car, mate. I drive a Polo 1.2. It's blue.
I drive a Ford Fiesta. It's Spanish for party.
I feel completely left out.
Do you drive?
I've never passed my driving test. I took it once and failed it so appallingly badly, I said I'm never ever going to drive again, and I haven't.
I respect you for that. I think if you fail your test three times, you should be banned for at least 10 years. People think they have a right to drive, and they're like, well, I'll get there in the end. Well, you're clearly shit at this. You have to be told to stop now. Like, I failed six times, but then I passed on the seventh. Well, you're probably still shit.
Do you drive, sir?
Yeah, I passed second time. Apparently, all the safest drivers are those who passed the second time. But I drove into oncoming traffic in my first one. But I didn't on the second one. But they don't teach you everything that you really need to learn to drive in the lessons, do they? They don't teach you, like, how to balance all your snacks on the passenger seat.
Open the crisps when you're at the services, because it's difficult to open them when you're driving along.
Yeah, but I can open a bottle between my thighs.
She can.
Really impressive if it's one of those Grolsch bottles. Shame out of you for that.
I think there should be different levels of test as well. I think there should be a test that you can drive without the radio on, and then there should be another test where you could drive looking at a text, making a phone call, chatting to your friends, and then there should be a high-level test where you're so good, you can have a few drinks. Okay, learning to drive. Let's have a look and see whether it's one of the most important moments in life. Yes, learning to drive. The Institute of Driving Instructors recommend taking 44 lessons before you attempt your test, in much the same way that McVitie's recommend you eat a lot of biscuits. OK, fingers on buzzers, one more thing to get.
Well, for a lot of people, it's getting married, isn't it?
Yeah,
it's making that choice.
Totally,
making that choice to get married, stay with somebody forever. I'm not married. We can't. I've been with my partner, stroke lodger, for...
She does not like it when you call her the lodger.
Many years. I'm not going to get married because I can't guarantee I'll be in a good mood on that day.
Fair enough.
Well, I thought it was interesting. Tim Burton and Helena Bonham Carter, they're married, but they have separate houses. I imagine that was Tim Burton's idea after he saw the plug hole when she'd had a bath. It looked like a Gibbons exploded.
Because I'm in a really nice relationship and it's gone really well, but we don't want to get married. So what we decided to do instead is we bought a box set of The Wire.
Good.
Instead of getting engaged, because it's about the same length of time, isn't it, as a relationship.
Realistically,
when we get to the end, you know, we'll review it and maybe get, you know, Mad Men or something.
Johnny, do you think you'll ever get married?
Here's the thing. If a woman wanted to be with me for the rest of her life, I would be so unsure of her mental stability that I would lose respect for her and I couldn't be with her for the rest of my life.
What if it was a clown?
Don't tease me, he's gone. Don't tease me.
You have that thing where it puts a lot of people off getting married. When you go on holiday, you know, you go on holiday and you see couples. And they've been on holiday for about 5 days, and you just see them sitting there having dinner for like the fifth night in a row, and they just go. And just, the waiter goes past, and they go. And that's because they haven't got anything to talk about. And me and my partner, stroke lodger, what we do is we pick a subject. We pick subjects, and that's what we talk about for that month. So. At the moment, it's like sort of we're talking about sort of British rodents. parachuting, the history of parachuting, you know, and that's a month, that's all we talk about. But we really cover that subject, and we've always got something to talk. And she goes, did you know, for example...
She doesn't actually Bruce Forsyth, aren't you?
Did you know that the vole can work through the root of a of an oak tree in under a minute? And I go, I didn't know that, love. And then you're away, you're off. You're chit-chattering. And then, like, next month, I'm doing World War II subs, and she's doing rock stars with beards. That's why I think we've got such a strong relationship. Pick a subject and that's... I mean, you could do a month, you could do... We'd do a year if you want.
Do you talk about anything else, though? So if she goes, like, oh, did you play the councils out? She goes... Off topic, vetoed.
I let that blend in, you know, if I'm not on a rant.
Let's have a look and see whether getting married is one of the most important moments in life. Yes, getting married. The average British marriage lasts 7 years, although with an extra Sky Plus box in the bedroom, that can be stretched to 8. So at the end of that round, Sean, Sarah and Lorraine have 3 points, John, Christian and Tom have 2 points. That's it for part one. See you after the break. Welcome back to 8 out of 10 Cats Uncut. Our next round is Pick of the Polls. Sean, Sarah, Lorraine, your turn first.
The little dog.
The dog.
The dog, OK. Here is a clip to illustrate your question.
I am fairly well known in the very short amount of time I've been doing taxidermy that I've managed to somehow end up doing seminars and whatnot. OK, we got some testicles here. Elk testicles. Now, those are some big boys. Oh, I've got everything in here. These are deer testicles, antelope testicles. This is my testicle creation. I'm very proud of this. Oh, yeah. I made these. This is deer. This came off a deer. This is buffalo hair. And this, I think, is quite authentic if you're trying to get just that perfect look. Dan, are there any animals with some good testicles showing? Oh my, this has got detail. He's got, you gotta see this. Wow. He's got the tip sticking out of the sheath. So that, I was not expecting that.
Okay, here's your related question. Most people would rather have a stuffed animal than a pet in their home, true or false?
Well,
most people would rather have a stuffed animal than a pet.
Most people in this country love pets, don't they?
Yeah,
they do. I mean, I would. I'd rather have. I don't like animals, so I'd rather have dead ones. Stuffed, when I say stuffed, I'd like to have them like chicken Kiev. I think the only good thing about having a pet, though, is if circumstances are tough, you can make a nice lunch out of a pet. Whereas a stuffed animal, you'd get a thin soup.
If it was stuffed, could you still make it warm? So you could have a stuffed animal, but then you could, I don't know, have it, you know, so that you could whack it in the microwave so that it's nice and warm, because then that would be quite comforting, wouldn't it? It'd be like having a hot water bottle, but with a face.
Another great Dragon's Den moment missed. We've got a stuffed elephant in our living room. I mean, no-one mentions it.
I mean, this thing about real animals and stuff, I've got both at home. I've got a real little doggy and I have a stuffed monkey.
And a warning doggy.
You've got a...
I've got a taxidermy monkey called Elsa. He's got this little face, little monkey face.
How's his monkey face going?
Actually, he looks quite pissed off that it's been stuffed, but yeah.
Can't have been happy.
It wouldn't be happy.
Can't have been dead.
So most people would rather have a stuffed animal than a pet in their home, true or false? What do you think?
Oh, that's false, Jimmy!
You think false. OK, what do you think, John?
We think it's false.
I can tell you. The answer is false. Yay. Yes. 74% of people would rather have a pet. I mounted a dead cat in my living room once. My girlfriend was on holiday and the internet was down. OK. John, Christian, Tom, what do you fancy answering on?
A bit of shame not to have the man who's ill while we have someone who can help him.
Yeah. Most people would rather diagnose themselves on the internet than visit a doctor. Is that true or false?
I think that is definitely true, yeah.
Do people come into the surgery now and go, well, I know you're a doctor, but I'm pretty sure I've read about this, I know exactly what it is.
They bring printouts. Great sheaves of printouts, of proof that they've got rare Unga Bunga disease and they know it.
And is there Unga Bunga going around?
Yeah.
The reason I would self-diagnose is because if you think you're ill, a doctor's surgery is going to make you iller, whereas you're not going to catch anything surfing around on the internet. So I still don't understand why doctor's surgeries are
as
the way they are.
They are.
In the way we've evolved, there's still a room where you go, get all the sick people in a small room and leave them there for hours. And nothing to do but cough and phleg all over everyone.
Yeah, but they've got a yachting magazine for you to protect yourself.
The worst thing is doctors diagnosing themselves. I've done it many times.
Well, how do you mean? What have you thought?
Well, I've nearly killed myself from appendicitis by ignoring it for a week, convincing myself it's just a bit of trap wind, I'll be all right. Until I was like, I couldn't walk like this. I had to drag myself to hospital with a galloping peritonitis. So
that's not great.
Not great.
Imagine. People still come to see you.
Not a good advert for my services.
If it had been trapped wind, though, the relief after a week.
Oh.
It's worth the gamble there, though, isn't it?
Tom, have you ever looked anything up on the internet when you've had a, you know, I don't know, you've just gone through puberty and stuff. Have you looked things up?
Strange things happen to my body. I'd definitely self-diagnose if I had the choice, because it would scare me if I did come to you, sir, and I had something exciting. You just stick it on the telly for everyone to look at.
Do you now meet patients and you look at it and you go, ooh. Do you want to be on telly? That is amazing. That is TV gold, because that is a disgrace. It's like a badger that's been hit with a shotgun, my God.
Can I just say that when I was doing my show, Friday Night Dinner, the show before that was Embarrassing Bodies, right? So it was my first time on telly, and I was really excited, and I get all my friends to gather around and watch it. And if they tuned in 10 minutes early, they were looking at someone's septic bell end. It's like my grandma ringing up, going, Tom, is that you? No, grandma, it's not. Give it 10 minutes.
I know you said you'd be on telly. What is the matter with you?
And I've kind of been blessed as well with the guests today, because Lorraine Kelly as well. Don't know whether you know this at all, but we kind of lived in the same village for like 16 years. Do you know my parents? You know Chrissy and Jim Rosenthal? Do you know them at all? Yeah, they're my mum and dad.
Are you the wee boy? Oh, that's just sweet.
So, like,
are we a cheese and wine boy?
But when I look at you now, you do look like your daddy.
Exactly. Oh, I've got a story as well. My mum told me this. My mum told me this story, that my dad is like, as you can testify, he's like a semi-celebrity in his own right.
Totally.
He's like a sports presenter. And they were opening the new post office, Sam and Rhonda's.
Salmon Rhonda, absolutely.
You know Salmon Rhonda from the post office.
I don't need anyone though, they're
like. So it's been happening on the internet. No,
Jim Rosenthal was booked in to open the post office, basically, until Lorraine Kelly became available. So my dad got shafted, sat in the living room going, what has Lorraine Kelly got that I do not?
I imagine he'll recover now watching his own son on TV going, my dad's a semi-celebrity.
Lovely. Oh, that's really. Isn't he gorgeous? He's really sweet.
Yes, you are. Who's a pretty boy? Yes, you are.
Okay, so most people would rather diagnose themselves on the internet than visit a doctor.
I like to ask a few people. If you get like best of five, you know, if three people think you should go to the doctors out of five, then you go to the doctors and you just lob it out, get a few people to have a look.
Lob it out?
Yeah. And then,
see,
you know.
Yeah, show a few people first. Because you must get annoyed with people going to the doctors that have got nothing as well. You must get annoyed by people just turning up and going, have a look at this.
Do you think people turn up and just show up?
Have you got the feeling that anyone's just shown up and gone, have a look at this?
Yeah.
That is a corker, isn't it? You don't see many like that, do you? That is perfect. We'll take a picture.
It happened to a colleague of mine. Yeah. She had to do an examination on a chap when she was a student and thought you had to examine the willy when it was hard, not floppy. So it was sort of best said to this man. I don't know who told her this. I think someone had wound her up.
Whoever did should get a special prize. I just have to examine you here.
Not really. But basically did just that.
had to give it. I just have to wake him up.
And it was an elderly gentleman who was examining,
who couldn't believe his luck.
Except that it took an awful long time to get there. I think another one of us students possibly had told her that this was the way you examine it.
And did she,
OK, so most people would rather diagnose themselves on the internet than visit a doctor, true or false? What do you think?
True, definitely true.
If the man says true, we go true.
OK, what do you think?
I don't know. I think I'd rather see a person. It's like, you know, when you go into supermarkets and they want you to go in that machine with your shopping? I hate that. I like to see a person. I've actually stood in the supermarket and said, can I please see a person? Because I can't get it to work.
Oh, she's saying person.
Person.
Right, we'll go false then.
I don't know.
Go false. OK, so I can tell you the answer is false. Well, yeah. 66% of people would rather visit a doctor. If I get diagnosed on the internet, I always make sure I get a second opinion from CFAX. So at the end of that round, it's 5 points for Sean's team and 3 points for John's team. That's it for part two. See you after the break. Welcome back to 8 out of 10 Cats Uncut. And the winner is the name of our final round. Here is your question. Best way to patronise someone?
Is it to ask them if they know what patronise means?
Is it just grow old? Because everybody patronises old people, don't they? You know, they just... they're, are you all right, dear? And they treat you as if you're a bit daft when you're older. Do you think? No? So not there?
I wasn't really listening, love. Sorry.
Is it if you say the word considering after a compliment? Like, oh, you did a really good job.
Ah.
Considering.
I always find the words, hey guys, do the trick. especially on a note. You're leaving a note out. Just wanna, hey guys. Think it's best we wash our own mugs after.
That is a note that you've written.
That's exactly, yeah. It's a note I've written several times because people never learn. Physical violence and they move out. So you see anyone moving around with four little dots on their head, they've had what I call the fork lesson.
Best way to patronise someone, what do you think? Because people often think doctors are a little bit patronising.
Yeah.
They just did it.
Very good. Very good.
He nailed that. My favourite bit of Embarrassing Bodies, and I love that, you know I love the show, I'm a big fan of the show. Oh, my yeah. favourite bit, they sit down and you have the chat, we fast forward through that, I don't know what you've ever said to someone. Then at the end of the chat you always go, well, let's have a little look, shall we? Pop up on the table. And that is where the fun begins. But it's just like, just pop your top off.
When you're in clinic, no one hears what you do or say, so we tend to say the same thing. It's always, hello, how can I help you? And it's like, pop your top. When you see it on television over and over and over again, you do realise we say exactly the same thing. Just pop up on the couch then and just pop your top off. We've had to sit down and basically have a think about other expressions we can use.
It's an instinct, though, isn't it? You do. It's like when you're moving down the aisle of a train and you always just say, can I just squeeze past you there? You just, no one ever thinks
you
to
have
say,
set
shift!
Best way to patronise someone?
You know, in restaurants, they have sommeliers, and it's part of their job is to be patronising. Okay, well, I think I can recommend probably you might choose or be in your price bracket. this wine, sir. And whenever they do that, I always do the same thing. After they've said, I recommend this wine, I go, thank you very much. And then I go, go on, run along.
Can I ask what a sommelier is? Because they don't have them in Nando's.
A Somalian.
I thought you said Somalian at first. I just have pop in that, so that's why that hasn't come up.
Pop.
Pop.
You don't have a pop at Pop Melier.
Pop.
No. Can I suggest the 7 Up with the
I love
the family bucket.
OK, so best way to patronise someone? I'll give you a clue. It suggests they're stupid.
Talk slowly to them.
Talk slowly is second. It implies you know more than they do.
I know more than you.
No, it's much more on the nose, right, rude. Okay.
Go fuck yourself, a-hole.
Yeah.
I will tell you. The best way to patronise someone is to say you wouldn't understand.
Ah, okay.
Women in the workplace get patronised a lot. If you're a professional woman and it's happened to you, don't you worry your pretty little head about it. When you patronise someone, you talk down to them nicely, whereas condescension can be quite rude. You got that, fuckwits? Well, that sound tells me it's the end of the round and the end of the show, which means the final scores are John, Christian and Tom have 3 points, Sean, Sarah and Lorraine are the winners with 6 points. Thanks to all our panellists, our wonderful studio audience, and to all of you watching at home. That's it from us. Good night.